Medication is certainly an option, but it's not the frontline intervention. Some of the key strategies within a cognitive behavioural framework include psychoeducation about anxiety, cognitive restructuring, and exposure. These strategies tend to be used in conjunction rather than entirely separate from one another. Psychoeducation involves educating clients about anxiety. This would include talking about the fact that anxiety is normal, that is often adaptive or helpful, and that we understand it to consist of three separate but interrelated systems: the cognitive, behavioural, and physiological systems. I would usually go through a cognitive behavioural model, such as the one we looked at before. I'd probably talk about some of the theories about how anxiety develops. All of this is helpful in giving people a general idea of how anxiety works. But then I'd be working with the client to come up with a very personalised formulation or way of understanding how their anxiety has developed and is being maintained. Cognitive restructuring requires that the client understand the importance of thoughts. Once this has been explained, typically using the ABC model, which, by the way, is an example of psychoeducation, we would be asking the client to start identifying the unhelpful thoughts that are making them anxious. The most common way of doing this is by having clients complete a weekly thought diary. Next, we work with our clients to help them evaluate the evidence for and against the likelihood of these thoughts being accurate. This is absolutely not about clinicians telling clients that their anxious thoughts are inaccurate or incorrect. Rather, it is about helping our clients to view their thoughts as theories to be tested, as opposed to facts that are true. So, when I'm working with anxious children, we use a cognitive approach that we call the scientific approach, where kids are encouraged to think of themselves as scientists whose job it is to evaluate the evidence for and against their hypotheses or anxiety-provoking thoughts. The kinds of questions we teach kids to ask themselves in gathering evidence include: are there other ways of thinking about this situation? And what advice would I give a friend who is in the same situation and having the same worried thoughts? With adults, the cognitive equivalent is known as Socratic questioning. The behavioural strategy of systematic desensitisation or exposure aims to address the avoidance of feared stimuli that tend to go hand in hand with anxiety. Cognitive restructuring is often, though not always, used in conjunction with exposure. This strategy is based on the psychological principle of habituation and involves deliberately and repeatedly placing yourself in anxiety-provoking situations that would normally be avoided. Developed by Wolpe in 1958, desensitization can be either imaginal, that is where the client is asked to imagine a series of increasingly anxiety-provoking situations, or in vivo, that is where the client actually places him or herself in increasingly anxiety-provoking situations. Treatment begins with the construction of a list of situations that provoke increasing amounts of anxiety, a hierarchy. Typically, in the past, relaxation techniques have been taught in conjunction with the use of desensitization. The rationale for using relaxation techniques was twofold. To begin with, relaxation was used to reduce the anxiety response that would typically be elicited by either the imagination or the actual experiencing of the avoided situation or stimulus. Second, relaxation was believed to improve a client's ability to imagine a feared situation. Today, however, relaxation techniques are far less commonly used in conjunction with desensitization. Indeed, most researchers and clinicians now believe that the use of relaxation strategies in this particular context actually constitutes a subtle form of avoidance. The current thinking, then, among most cognitive behaviorally oriented therapists is that anxious clients need to fully experience their anxiety and realize that it's not going to harm them, and that the teaching of relaxation techniques for specific use in working through an exposure hierarchy actually hinders this process. As we previously noted, the aim is to fully experience the anxiety that would normally result in avoidance and to realize that you can handle both the situation and the anxiety that it provokes. Each of the situations that make up the hierarchy needs to be experienced, either imaginally or in real life, repeatedly, until the fear response has been extinguished. The most common behavioral response to anxiety is avoidance. Avoidance means that the individual misses out on the opportunity to discover that he or she actually can cope with that feared situation. Instead, avoidance serves to strengthen and reinforce anxiety. Let's have a look at the steps involved in developing an exposure hierarchy. Identify the feared situation. Break the feared situation down into as many different component parts as possible, identifying variables that make a difference to how anxiety-provoking the situation is. Then list the components as specifically as possible and rate each from 0 to 100 in terms of its difficulty. Rearrange the items in order of increasing difficulty. And finally, implement the hierarchy. Let's look at an example exposure hierarchy for a child who is currently fearful of sleeping in their own bed. As you can see in this hierarchy, each step is becoming a little more difficult than the preceding one. The child would start on the first or bottom step, and they would practice this step every night until they felt confident to go up to the next step, and so on. For example, the first step here is for the child to sleep on a mattress beside mum and dad's bed. The next step is to sleep on a mattress outside mum and dad's bedroom door. Then, have mum or dad sit with me until I fall asleep in my own bed and have a nightlight on. Have mum or dad sit with me for 10 minutes and have a nightlight on. Sleep in my room with a nightlight on. Sleep in my own room with the hall light on. Then finally, sleep in my own room with no light. An exposure hierarchy is intrinsically rewarding. By the time a person gets to around about the third step, they're feeling really good about what they have already achieved. And they're beginning to think that maybe, just maybe, they can even get to that top step. However, because by definition, we're asking clients to do things that they find anxiety provoking, it is also very common, and certainly when you're working with kids and adolescents, to link an exposure hierarchy to an external reward system in which they can earn small rewards for working on their hierarchy. I want to end with this question. What if you know someone with an undiagnosed mental health problem? People are much more likely to seek help from a friend or family member than from a professional. Here are some resources you may find useful to assist anyone.